If you'd rather go to the dentist than negotiate your job offer, then this video is for you. If you think you're pretty good at negotiating, but are open to learning new tips, then this video is for you. Over the years, I've interviewed with thousands of candidates, negotiated hundreds of times, and I've observed some techniques that work really well. And today I'm going to be sharing 10 such techniques with you. And towards the end of this video, we're going to share a real life scenario where you receive an offer which is lower than your expectations, and what can you do and what can you say to bump it back up to where you would like it. Coming right up. Hi everyone, welcome back to Supercharge. My name is Sonal, an HR director, and this channel is all about sharing practical tips on how to supercharge your career. We all know negotiation is important. However, only 30% on average of all candidates ends up negotiating, which is kind of sad if you really think about it. And of those 30%, 46% are men and 34% are women. So if you measure the amount of money lost by not negotiating over one career, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars, and that's life-changing. Why should you not have some of that? So today we're going to be doing exactly that, and let's get started. The first tip I have for you is related to the fear mindset. The number one reason that candidates do not negotiate their job offer is they have a fear that the employer will take the job offer away. I can tell you, I've never seen that happen. Employers do not take the job offer away because you tried to negotiate. The second fear that candidates have is that if they try to negotiate their salary, the employer will not like them, or they will appear too greedy or money-minded. I can tell you, nothing is further from the truth. When a candidate is trying to negotiate with me, I have a lot of respect for that candidate. In fact, those are real skills that I'm going to be seeing on the job. So there's nothing wrong with it. Third fear that candidates have is if they ask for an amount, the employer will say no. So what? That's status quo. And there is a reason that fear is actually false expectations appearing real. So punch that fear in the face and move on. The second tip I'd like you to keep in mind is imagine that you and the employer are in the same team. Always imagine it this way as opposed to an adversarial sort of approach, you know, me versus them, I'm in it, it's a battle. No. The employer has taken months to find you. They had hundreds of CVs, they interviewed 7 or 8 people, they had top 2 candidates. You're number one because you got the offer, and nobody makes an offer to 2 candidates at the same time. They have a backup probably, and that's it. They are not interested in starting this process all over again. Their aim is to make sure you are happy with the offer you receive. Your aim is to make sure you are happy with the offer you receive. So you have the same goal if you think about it, and never forget that. The third tip I have is it's really important to do your homework. I've said this lots of different times in other videos and I'll link that up. It's important to talk to headhunters and look at data online and know what is your worth in the market, in your industry, and in your location. Once you've done your homework and you know the salary ranges in your area, the fourth thing that you need to keep in mind is know your man. Your man, your minimum acceptable number as far as salary is concerned. And think of your man plus 10%. That is the figure you should be asking when you have an offer in front of you. Next tip I have for you is related to the cash component of your offer. I know everyone says it's important to look at the whole package and that makes a difference, and I completely agree. However, do that after you have seen your cash component, which is your salary and your bonus. It's like a company. They have something called an operating cash flow, which helps them through month on month, and you should be doing the same. So if possible, speak with your hiring manager and see if you can ask HR to calculate a gross to net calculation so that when you do start in the company, there are no sort of surprises when you see deductions that you had not thought about before. The next thing to keep in mind is everything is negotiable. When I say everything, I mean everything. The salary, the bonus, the holidays, childcare for your children, if that's possible, schooling for your kids. If you're relocating to another place, what about your relocation expenses, your house search, the rent for your house, language lessons for you, spouse assistance if your spouse has to give up his or her job. There's really no end to it, and the more you ask, the more you get. If you don't ask, forget it. Another tip, which is sort of obvious and I know it goes without saying, is if you have another offer, it is leverage that helps you, and you are in a luxurious position to compare and see what's best for you. However, one thing I will say is do it the right way. Do not hold the other offer on the person's head like some sort of threat. When people do that, I immediately lose interest. So it's not just about using this as leverage, but how you use it, which is really important. And that brings me to the next point. Always be polite when it comes to the job offer and when you have to negotiate. You always get something when you ask nicely, right? That's what we tell children, and it's no different for us. So use language like thank you so much, you know, show gratitude. Would it be appropriate if we could discuss this? I understand your concerns, and you know, that sort of language really goes a long way. The tip number 9 is related to time. And take the time you need. Do not accept or reject any offer the moment you receive it. You need to go home, think on it with a calm head and probably with family as well. So the last tip is a rather strange one. And to explain this tip, I'm going to ask you to think in your head that it's Monday morning, you get into the office, you have 200 unread emails, so you're not exactly in a great mood, and someone asks you for a favor, and then the last thing you want to do is listen to them, right? However, if they ask you something on a Thursday or a Friday, you're in a better mood, you want to get things done and go into the weekend. And the same thing goes in a negotiation process. If possible, try and start the negotiation process on a Thursday, and if it's not too complicated, it will finish by Friday, so in a day or two. I have seen that work when people, you know, negotiate with me towards the end of the week. I'm in a very, very good mood to close it, so it's done before my weekend even begins. So now let's imagine a real life scenario where you receive an offer in person, and the man plus 10% in your head is 75,000, and you receive an offer for 67,000. So you receive the offer, you look at it, be absolutely quiet, study it. Don't be the first one to speak, because you are now making the other person on the other side of the table a little bit nervous because you're not saying anything, and they're going to try to say something to break the silence. You are total zen. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you making me the offer and showing your trust in me. Absolutely. I have a couple of questions that I'd like to talk to you about, if that's okay. I see here that, so the annual salary is 67,000, yeah, right? Based on my research on the market and my past experience, I was actually expecting a salary more in the range of 75,000. You've made it clear that you want more, right? Now the other party is listening to you, and let's imagine they say, yeah, we understand, but we have no budget and our hands are tied. Okay, they always say that, trust me. So you say, okay, I see. Yes, I do understand what you mean. It's just that based on all my success that I've had in the previous organization that I expect to bring to your organization, I was just hoping for a number more in the range that I just shared with you. Okay, you've made it clear. And let's assume they still say no. Things are getting a little bit heated up. But that's okay. You anticipate all these objections because you went prepared. The next thing you can do is, you can ask them, do you have a practice of a sign-on bonus? Because that could sort of help bridge the gap that I have in my head. There's two answers that you can expect to this. Yes, we do that sometimes. And if they say that, you're pretty much in the victory zone. Or they say they don't do that. Not great. So would it be appropriate to ask you for something? Do you have a process where in 3 to 6 months, you can review my performance based on some criteria? And if I meet those criteria, that my salary can be bumped up to 75,000. Now you've put them in an uncomfortable situation. You've talked about your value, you've talked about a sign-on bonus, and you've talked about a performance appraisal at the end of 3 to 6 months. If they say no to all of this, listen, understand it, and if needed, you need to be prepared to walk away if you are not happy. That's scenario number 1. Let's imagine scenario number 2, where they're listening to everything you're saying, they are going to go into a room somewhere and talk to the head of HR or the boss of the hiring manager and come back 10 minutes later. It's a little bit theatrical. And they come back into the room and they say, okay, based on everything that you've said, we do understand, and the maximum we can offer you is 70. So you're listening, you're saying, 70, I see. Well, thank you so much. That does go a long way in bridging the gap that is between 67 and 75. I do appreciate it. Can I just say, however, that I think I deserve more? You're obviously prepared for all sorts of objections. You are not giving in, you're sticking to your guns, but at some point, if it's not working out, you do need to know when to stop. Based on my experience, I can share with you, if you've used all these 10 techniques and towards the end, where things get a little bit tight and they say budget is a problem, and you use these three options that I just spoke about, at some point or the other, they will give in because they do want you, because the thought of going back and starting the process all over again, or even offering their second best candidate, is a nightmare, and nobody wants that. So that's it, that's my approach. And in case you're thinking, oh gosh, these are great tips, but they're difficult to remember, not to worry. I've laid out all my tips in an acronym format. I've done that for you. And remember the last time in my previous video when we talked about why should we hire you and what makes you unique? We talked about you showing them what a rock star you are. So now imagine you're a rock star, but you've shot to fame. And this approach is exactly that, shot to fame. So a quick recap. Remember, you're on the same team. Always do your homework in terms of what you can expect for your salary in the market. Look at the operating cash flow, which literally means focus on the cash component, and if possible, ask them to calculate a gross to net calculation. If possible, try and approach the negotiation process on a Thursday. Take all the time you need. Do not accept or reject at face value. If you have another offer, it's always helpful, but ask nicely. You have to punch fear in the face, because any fear you have of negotiation is not real. Always be polite and courteous. Do not shatter goodwill that you've built all this time. Always know your man, minimum acceptable number, and then in your head, add 10% to the man. So that is your asking price. And lastly, keep in mind, everything is negotiable. So with the shot to fame approach, I'm pretty sure you will land very comfortably into the man zone. And this is the end of the video. I hope this was useful. And if so, goes without saying, give it a thumbs up, show it some love. I would really appreciate it. Share it with your friends, subscribe. There's plenty more. And I shall see you in the next video. Ciao.